In today's session, we are going to see how to copy files from one file to another file or one directory to another directory. So to copy files in Unix operating system, we are going to use a command called cp. So cp is going to copy files or directories, but if you just use the cp command, it is going to copy a file. If you want to copy a directory, you need to use cp minus r. R stands for recursively. If you have multiple files within a directory, everything if you want to copy, you must use R. Otherwise, only parent directory is going to get copied. This is my Linux console and I just created it. If you want to see how long the session is up and running, it is running from past 3 minutes only. Just now I have created, right? So let me create some files over here. As of now, there is no files. Touch file one. Sorry. File one, file two, file three. Now I have created three files. I am writing some data in one of these files. For that, I am using file VA. VA is another way of editing our file. I'm editing my file. Let me write some data over here. This is a test file which created with VA editor. Okay, just I have created and I saved it. Now if I open file one, you could see the data whatever you have written. Now I want to copy this data into other file called file 10. Then I can use cp file one to file 10. Here first one would be the source, nothing but which file you want to copy. This one is the destination. If you see here, now new file got created called file 10, and if I open cat file one, cat file 10, both are going to have the same data. You just copied the data into file 10. Similar way, you can copy your file into other directory also. Other directory nothing but currently you are under root. You want to copy this file from root directory to your EC2 minus user home directory. Then you can specify. Before that, let me open new session for EC2 minus user. Right, so if you see my present working directory, I am under slash home EC2 minus user, and there is no files under this directory. And here I am under root directory. I have four files. Now I want to copy file one into EC2 minus user home directory. For that, I can use cp file one slash home slash EC2 minus user. This is the path of EC2 minus user home directory. And you can see here you are under slash home slash EC2 minus user, and I'm giving just enter, and I'm going back to EC2 minus user home directory. And if I run ls now, you can see the file one. Just now this file has been created. You can see the timeline, Jan 25th 2 28. If I see date, it is same, Jan 25th 2 28. That is how you can copy your file from one location to another location, right? Now I am going to show you how to copy a directory. To copy a directory, first I am creating a directory, mkdir dir1. Under root directory, I have root path, I have created directory one. Now let me go inside to dir1. To switch to inside to dir1, we can use cd. Now under this we don't have any files. I mean to say slash root slash dir1, we don't have any files. Let me create few files. So touch file 5, file 6, file 7, and also I'm going to create mkdir dir2 dir3. So now what I have done is, under dir1 I have created two directories and two files. Now I want to copy entire directory onto ec2 minus user home directory. For that I am switching back so that I will be under root directory, and I can able to copy this dir1. So cp dir1 slash home slash ec2 minus user. So if I execute this command, it is going to just copy dir1, but whatever content is there inside to dir1, it won't copy. For example, in this case we have dir2, dir3, file 5, file 6 are there within dir1. All this content cannot be copied. So to copy all this content, we are going to use cp minus r. R stands for recursive. Let me execute this command. Let me execute without r, then we'll execute with r, right? So we can see the difference. I am not specifying minus r, nothing but recursive. Omitting directory dir1 because it has without r you cannot able to copy dir. Cp minus r dir1 slash home slash ec2 minus user. Now it has been copied, and let me go and see. You can see now dir1 has been copied. If I go to dir1, you can see whatever files are there. That is how you can copy a file. File nothing but you can directly use cp, but whenever you are using dir, you need to use minus r option. Next one, we have one more command, that is cp minus p, nothing but preserve the timestamp. For example, if you have created a file 10 days before, now you want to copy that file into other location, but you must need a same time. Whenever you copy into other location file will get the latest timestamp. If you don't want to get the latest timestamp, old date itself, if you need, you need to use minus p. It is going to preserve the timestamp also. So source file, which date it has been created, destination timestamp also will come same thing. I'm showing the example now. I'm under root directory. So if you see here, we have created file 3 on Jan 25th to 2525, nothing but around 5 minutes before. Now if I copy cp file 3 onto slash home slash ec2 minus user, if I go here, ls minus l or ll I can use. I should go one step ahead. I mean to say one step back. So now file 5 has been created, but it comes with the latest timestamp because current date is, it is 2:23. But I just want to get the 2:25 itself. Then you can use cp minus p. Minus p nothing but preserve your timestamp. File 2 onto slash home slash ec2 minus user. And this time what it will happen, whatever timestamp you are having on file 2 over here, with the same timestamp the file has been created into the destination location. If you see here, you got the 225 itself. That is how you can preserve your timestamp. So we are going to use mv command to move data from one location to another location, or move data from one file to another file. We also use mv command to rename your file. So to move your data from one location to another location, or moving your files from one location to another location, we are going to use a command called mv. So let's jump into console and we'll execute this. Here I have multiple files and directories, and this is my ec2 minus user, and here I have similar files. I'm removing all files. To remove, rm minus rf star. So if you use rm minus rf star, in the current location whatever files and directories are there, everything is going to get removed. Okay, permission denied because these are all created by root user. Let me execute as a root. right? I have deleted all the files as a root. So now if I run ls minus l command or ll, you cannot see any data under user's home directory. Let's go back and I want to move some files from my root directory to EC2 minus user home directory. Then I can do mv command file2 to slash home slash EC2 minus user. Whenever I execute this command, the file2 is going to disappear from the source file, nothing but current location, the file2, whatever is there, that will be moved into destination location. Let me execute it. And now if you see here, you don't find file2, but in the destination location, sorry, did I give right path? So I have re-login as a EC2 minus user. I don't have any files under this directory. Let me copy it from my root. Okay. Under root, we have multiple files. I want to move file one onto EC2 minus user. Then I need to provide mv command file one slash home slash EC2 minus user slash file one. Because we have done a mistake earlier, because we didn't provide the destination file. If I give this one, file one will be moved into the current location as a file one. If you want to rename the file name also while copying, you can do by using mv. Nothing but you want to move on to file 11. Before executing this command, I'm going to show you in the destination path, there is no files. Let me copy it into the destination path as a file 11. And in current location, you cannot see file one, but in destination location, you could be able to see file 11. Okay. That is how you can move your data from one location to another location. And also we can use mv command as a, what I can say, renaming the file name. For that, we can use mv file 3, file 30. Now, what I'm doing is, whatever data is there under file 3, I'm copying into the file 30. Once this command has been executed, file 3 get disappear and you are going to get file 30. Now, if I execute ls, you can see here, earlier we are having file 3. Now, file 3 has been renamed it as a file 30. Actually, it is not going to rename, it is going to copy entire thing into the file 30. That's how we can use mv command as a renaming operator. Next thing, how to create files or removing files. We have discussed already about this one. So touch is to create a file, and mkdir is to create a directory, and rmdir is to remove the empty directory. If you have some data within the directory, rmdir cannot work. That's why we are using rm minus rf. Rf nothing but R means recursive, F means force. That is why RF is going to remove everything forcefully, whether if it is important data or not. So we should be careful while executing RM minus RF command. Next, we are going to use the DF command. I'm going to switch into the disks. Before going to the DF command, I want to execute one more command. So system configuration commands. So usually we want to know how many disks are there, what is the memory, what is the CPU you are having on your system, what and all processes are running. Those we want to know, there are certain list of commands you need to execute. So if you want to see the number of disks, which are how many are attached to your server, you can use a command called lsblk. lsblk is a command which is going to show you how many volumes, nothing but disks, are attached to your system. So currently to my system, only one disk is attached. In Unix, it is going to treat it as a XVDA, XVDB, XVDC, something like that. So here, this is the disk, and I have a 8GB disk attached to this system. And you cannot use directly a disk in Unix operating system. So that's why we will convert a disk into a partition. So from this disk, we have created a partition called XVDA1. This is the partition we are using it. So to find out disks, we are going to use lsblk as a command. And the next thing what we are going to do is, I quickly add a one more volume to the same server, and let me execute this one so you can find a new volume. give me 1 minute, I'm going to do that. What I have done is through AWS, I have attached one more volume to this server. Let me execute the command. And 5 GB disk I have attached. You could able to see the 5 GB new volume. That's how you can identify your additional volumes. Once you have created, once you have find your volumes, you need to create it as a partitions. Once it is created as a partition, then you can convert into as a file system, right? But it is not scope of our work. Now what I am going to show you is, I am going to show you how to find out the memory of your system. This is to find out the disks, how many disks are there in your system. And free minus m is tell you the memory of your system. If you see here, this is the memory. I'm using T2 micro instance type. So it is going to get 1 GB of memory. You are getting 993, remaining is reserved. That's why you cannot able to see 1024, right? This is how you can identify how much memory it is allocated. Out of that, how much memory you are using, how much memory is free, right? So free minus m is to identify memory. Next one would be the cat slash proc slash CPU info. This is the command to find out how many CPUs you are having in your system. This is to identify memory, free minus m, and cat slash proc slash CPU info to identify your CPUs. Okay, in this output, you can see there is a CPU cores. You are having one CPU core, nothing but one processor is attached to this system. That is how you can identify what is the processor it is having. And if you want to see what is the model number of your CPU, you have the Intel or Exxon. Okay, all this information, you are going to get little more information in the slash proc slash CPU info, right? Next one would be the top. Top is going to give the top utilized processors information, nothing but in your system, which processes are consuming more CPU on your system. So top is going to give that information. But one more advantage with the top is, it is going to show you the CPU utilization and memory utilization of your system. So here, if you see CPU utilization, as of now, we are not using much. 100% is ideal. Okay, ID stands for ideal, US stands for user, SY stands for system. Okay, that is how you can identify. And you can see here, these are the processors. There is no application on this system. Only root is executing all the commands. So root itself is consuming the whatever CPU it is using. And also you can find out the memory. This is the total memory is available, and used is this much, and free is this much, and buffered is this much. So top is the one of the useful command. If your system is not functioning or it is very slow, you can use top command to find out what is the CPU and memory utilization of your system. If you want to come out from the top command, you need to just give the Q, nothing but quit. You will come out from your top command execution. Otherwise, it will be keep on running, and it just show you top 10 processors which are consuming more CPU utilization. So I'm going to see you df minus h. So df minus h is a command which will show you the file systems, and just to treat it as a file system, nothing but drives in Windows. File systems, nothing but drives in Windows. So we have around 8 GB data. Out of 8 GB data, nothing but 8 GB disk, we have converted using here 7.8 GB. And here it is a temporary space. It has been used out of this one. These two are used from this particular disk itself. Here we are using 448 MB and 497 MB. So whenever you want to see how many file systems are there in your system, you need to use df minus h command. Next command would be find. Through the find command, you can able to find your files. It's like a search in Windows. You have some file and you don't know where exactly it has been created. you want to search it, you will search for that particular file, right? If you know the file name. Similar way, assume that you have created one file and you don't know where exactly you have created in your Linux system, you can use the find command. I'm going to show you how to execute that command. So to execute find command, you need to execute find slash slash nothing but entire system. Starts from the slash minus name nothing but you need to specify the file name. Assume that I have created file one. I don't know where exactly I have created in this system. I want to search for that one. Now what does it exactly do is it is going to search for file one entire Linux system and it gives file one wherever it finds. In our system there is no file one at all, okay, because I think we have renamed file one as a some other file name. That's why you could not able to find. Let me try to find for file 10 or file 5. So we know that file 5 is there, sorry, file 6. File 6 is there under slash root slash dir1. But let's search for this. You can see here slash root slash dir1. There is a file 6. If you have same file in the multiple locations, it is going to display all the locations wherever it find the file 6. So to search your files, you are going to use the find slash minus name followed by your file name, whatever file name you have. Okay, right. Next command would be gzip or gunzip or zip or unzip. These are the commands we are going to use. This is the commands we are going to use to unzip or zip your files. Okay, let's go and execute. So assume that I have some file which is having a larger huge data. Now I want to zip that file because I want to free up some space. Then you can use a command called gzip. Gzip is a command to zip your file. Assume that in current location we have file 6. I want to zip this file. Now if you see here, actual file has been zipped into the gz extension. Okay, now again if you want to read this data, you need to unzip and read the data. Directly you cannot read this one until you use the zcat, that is another command. But best way is unzip this file and you can read the data. So to unzip, g unzip is a command to unzip the file. Now again the file has been restored as a normal file. So you can use gzip or g unzip command to zip or unzip your file. Apart from gzip, you can use zip also, I hope. Zip file 6. Okay, zip is not working. And compress also will work. File 6. Okay, compress is not there because we need to install the respective package. Depending upon operating system, we may use either gzip or zip or compress, whatever commands, but all commands are going to do the similar task. It is going to zip your data and it is going to unzip whenever you execute the unzip command. Right? And one more thing, zip command is going to work on files. You cannot zip what I can say directories. If I give gzip dir2, it won't work because it is a directory. Now if you want to zip a directory, you need to use a command called tar. Tar is a command to zip your directory. We'll see. So to rm minus rf dir1 dot tar, because I'm going to do it again. So to zip your directory, you are going to use a command called tar minus cvf. Okay, to archival your directory. So dir1 dot tar and dir1. So this is the directory I want to tar. Once it is tarred, it has to copy it into dir1 dot tar. So yes, tar minus cvf dir1 dot tar dir1. There is a typo. So now it has been tarred. And next, assume that I am deleting this directory rm minus rf dir1 and now still I can able to restore it from our dir1.tar. So tar minus xvf is a command to untar your file. Now if you see here, again directory has been created. Under this one you have our files and directories. That is how the tar is going to work. Right, now we are going to see wc and sort command. So wc stands for word count. You can count the words within your file or characters within your file by using the wc command. And also similar way, we can use the sort command to sort your data within your file. That is the what it is going to do in this one. So let's go and execute this command. In current location, I'm going to remove EC2 minus user. It is not needed. Right. In current location, I have file 30. And if I do cat file 30, nothing is there. Let me write some data on file 30. This is file 30. First, second line, third line. Okay, just I have kept some data in this one. Oops, that's okay. I have written some data in this file. This is what you have written in this file. Now you want to count how many words are there, or how many lines are there, how many characters are there in this file. You can just give the wc command. Wc command is going to give that it has 4 lines with 9 words and 39 characters on file 30. That is the output it is going to give with the wc command. But if you just want to know only lines, wc minus l file 30. L stands for lines. It is going to give how many lines are there. Similar way, wc minus w, nothing but only word count it is going to give. Wc minus w, sorry, c. C stands for characters. It is going to give only characters. That is how wc command is going to work. And sort is a command which is going to sort your data. Okay, now you can see here you have written file. This is a file, and second line, third line, it has been sorted 2, 3, then t, because it is going to take in as a ASCII value. So according to that, it is going to sort your data. Right. Particular file is existing on your if you want to search particular word in your file, you can use the grep command. So it is going to search entire your file, and it gives the entire line of that file where it finds the particular expression. So in this case, if you see, you have file 30. Now you want to search for the second is there in this file or not. You can just grep second. This is the what I want to search under file 30. Now it is going to display that, okay, second line. In second line, there is a second is there. That's why it is going to give that one. Similar way, grep first, file 30. So first is not there in this one, so it won't write any data. So grep is going to search for the particular pattern is exist in your file or not. That is how we are going to use a grep. It's something like a find in our Windows. So we can use the find, and you can search for a particular word, right? Similar way, you can search in the Linux by using the grep command.